lecture for the day is Elizabeth Waldo. After you all heard of Elizabeth. She's a violinist, folklorist, composer. She was educated initially at Curtis Institute of Music in Philadelphia. She was lead violinist under the direction of Leopold Stravinsky for 2 years. She was first violinist with the Los Angeles Philharmonic. She has held teaching positions at California State University, Los Angeles, University of Southern California, Occidental College, a researcher, Inter-American University in Panama, the Fine Arts Library at University of New Mexico in Albuquerque, and she has received a variety of awards, such as the Bronze Flutist Award for TV score, the Gold Medal winner in Mexico City for contributions to international understanding of Pan-American music, Composer's Award for contributions to American music, Radio and Television Award for noteworthy achievement in the field of serious music, and an Emmy Award nomination. She has composed a whole variety of musical sets, and one is Barrio Suite, Conquistador Suite, and Inca Sundance, to name a few. And without further ado, Elizabeth Waldo.
Thank you so very, very much. Of course, this is an exciting moment to be here with all of you, and I think I should start out by saying, Viva los fandangos para ahora y para siempre. Certainly that's in the spirit of this wonderful series and this beautiful library, and I share with all the world the romance and the joy of being at San Juan Capistrano. It's just something in my work and in my memory for a long, long period of time. Actually, I think it would be better due to the shortness of time. One of the things I have fallen in love with are the mission bells. The history, the old ones, and the dear gentleman, Paul Arbiso, who helped me and showed me, you know, the various ways, the announcement of one toll, two tolls, and what they all meant. And then, of course, I discovered that they were electronically run today. So I felt that this kind of inspired a composition to coordinate the music right into the bells, which will cut short our time, but perhaps will get the atmosphere of what we're going to do. So I feel that these marvelous dimensions of this series are so beautifully covered. When I first started to involve myself in the first period, which is the Indian period, I don't think there were any Dr. Keelings around that I could identify with and consult. The only person that helped me start with this was the late Eleanor Haig, and she was the first person to write a book of Latin America and Hispanic area music of the New World, and of course that's where I started in the other Latin countries, principally Mexico, Panama, and South America. And she said at that time that when I got to California, it would be the most difficult because precisely there weren't these avenues available for anyone. So with that as a background, then coming into the early California section, I found this to be quite true. But let me tell you how things have improved in that direction since, for instance, on the Mexican period of music and dance, when the Ballet Folklorico Mexicano started here touring all over the world, that in itself opened up an avenue of thought and research for most people who hadn't given the heritage of our state much consideration, I feel. And it isn't the barren musical wasteland that it was when I actually weaned myself away from the Western classical world and started developing the resources and making the research. Because now just about every high school and every junior high and all kinds of church organizations everywhere has a ballet folklorico of its kind. So the public is becoming aware of this side of the Mexican contribution. And when you go back further, the only way I could start was by the chronicles, the reports of the explorers, and the people who had made a study of the general area. There wasn't too much available, but now here we have this beautiful feeling that we can go to a folklorico to hear certain things. However, I'm against the idea that if a concert or a program is being given, that they hire a mariachi band and say that's early California music and they play Guadalajara. This sort of goes against my idea of what I feel it should be, this beautiful potpourri of blending the Spanish, the Mexican, and in these wonderful periods. And don't let me get on other immigrant music, because that in itself is a very fascinating subject, but not particularly with our today's format. For instance, I am working on the Chinese music of early California, or at least what I think it might have been, but in a translation that it could be understood and presented today. You see, I think this course is very well structured, because my position actually is to study these wonderful ethnic resources now that are becoming increasingly available, and then to put them in an art form. Because really, to take a straight Indian reservation sound and even personnel onto the concert stage, it's a very difficult transition. The atmosphere is not quite there, and some songs are abrupt. They're not readily understood by a wide variety of concert-going people. And in fact, when I first started with this, bringing the Aboriginal instruments into the orchestration, I was told, Elizabeth, you'll never have an audience to hear Indian idioms or California Indian idioms or any Indian music or styles. And so it did seem for a while that I was kind of working in the dark in doing this, and some people say, oh, here comes that crazy lady with her bag of crazy instruments. So I think that has largely been eradicated now, and I just feel there's just a marvelous fresh breeze blowing, and that one can go into these realms of these odd musical sounds and dimensions and frequencies, and some of them really are very far out. They're not what we would expect to hear. But after all, the Indians did it first. They have the owl calls through their music, they have coyote calls, and I see nothing wrong with putting that into an art form in conjunction with standard instrumentation. There again, it is difficult to find performers who understand the blend of this. You know, we are very locked in as musicians to a Western tradition, a Western European tradition. And it is very hard for regular musicians to perform this music, because they're not equipped to cope with the exact needs of it. Extension of bar lines, bending of phrases, lyrical approaches, dynamic approaches, hearing thunder come through the music. There are so many changes from a Mozartian. And actually, I've had some musicians, before I could discern myself, who would be able to use these instruments in the manner that I envision. This may have some tomb dust or something. Dude, I couldn't possibly play this. Oh, really? I said, well, to me, that's just, that has a beautiful, like a kind of pre-Hispanic, pre-Columbian perfume. I don't mind it at all. Actually, and I think that is where it parts from pure archaeological point of view to put it on a shelf just to look at it. Like I always, as a student, I would see a Stradivarius in a case. And I would weep because I said, I want to hear it. It's going to decay not being played. So, any rate, after our musicians become involved with the style, it really is adaptable to all of these ways. Now then, I must be harking back to either Aztec, Mayan ancestry or Tang Dynasty ancestry, from which there are many things in common with the pre-Columbian, the ancient world of the Americas. For instance, another contrast between this and Western approach, Western European that is that all of the art forms blend together. And I think they're terribly unrelated. I mean, they are all related. If you're having the music, the dance weaves into it, the poetry, the voice, every aspect of it. I mean, weaving, pottery. In fact, I go to any of these sources to find clues of the artisans who have been here and who've created. I see the designs in the mission. And this gives me a feeling, oh, wouldn't I have loved to have been there in the days and any mission and seen the Indians playing on their flutes up there and then with their bowl of water to make the kind of tambor sound they made and even blowing the whistles in the water. All of these things appeal to me very much. So at any rate, in our presentations, what we're doing, striving for, is again to put these all back together. So our program today does consist of singing and dancing, and I've asked our dancers, because they say visual is worth a thousand words, and when I came with my big portfolio, Ricardo said, Elizabeth, what on earth are you going to do? Well, I said, this is my lecture. He said, what? He said, you mean that's your course. Just no time to go into all of the details. The Indian world has been so beautifully covered, and I want to have many more opportunities to work with Dr. Keeling. And so we are incorporating an Indian world too, but it will be a new area of sounds and in a contemporary sense. I feel that in one way I'm very lucky in this generation because I love the beautiful work that was done by Cadman, for instance, and his Bells of Capistrano, his operetta, courtesy of one of my dear mentors, Dr. Neuerberg, who presented me with this score, and I think it's absolutely fantastic for research. However, these beautiful period of composers in the Indian idiom wrote it as an idyllic sort of thing because the piano was their only medium to get across some of the expression. Whereas today we are getting the timbre, the feeling, the sensuality of some of the other approaches to it. So perhaps that can reflect a wave of Indian material for the future, even going vice versa, translating the Aboriginal instruments into concert form. There again, you can do it with Western instruments if you first have the imagination, and secondly, don't mind bending the rules on Western European music. It can be done. So that had been my dream to do today, just briefly on the Indian and the Spanish-Mexican period with its wonderful overtones. And but I feel that time will run out if we're going to make the bells. So that is very important to the mood of our program. So Ricardo and Juana, if you would please come forward here, and we just have about 5 minutes. I was going to play, assistant, if you just quickly show me a couple of these things. Hand me this one next, and just a couple of sonic things here. My dear whose I dearly love. This is from one of the puberty ceremonies. And this was a courtesy of Craig Bates, who, bless his heart, helped me a lot with the study of the Maidu area in the Tuolumne. And that would be played like this. Is Apache, and the bridge always makes the variation in pitch. But may I present two of our wonderful artists, Ms. Juana Escobar and Mr. Ricardo Peinado, and they each represent different styles. Juana, would you just like to do very rapido the kind of like the classic Spanish entering into the California dance, and then you maybe in a two-sentence commentary about what you did, and then Ricardo, I'll let you make up your own words because I don't know what our time will permit you to.
There are four types of dancing in Spain. You have your classical Spanish dance, which is the Escuela Bolera. Then you have Spanish dancing, which is what a lot of the American public is used to seeing. Then you have flamenco and the regional dances, folk dances of Spain. The type of movements that I'm going to be doing will be of the Spanish dance idiom. And then I'm going to briefly go into demonstrating some of the footwork which later permeated into early Californian dance forms and also Mexican dancing. So there's the use of the arms and the tap of the neck. And for the footwork,
area, and to understand that, you have to understand that the Aztecs and the Indians, before the conquest by the Spaniards or Cortez, there were about 180 tribes living in the Mexican area, which is all of the geographical Mexican area that we know today. And they were conquered, of course, and they, of course, their culture became obsolete. And their music originally consisted of the Indians, or speaking of the Indians, and especially in particular the Aztecs. Consisted of percussive sounds, the huepetl, the double-tongued wooden drum instrument, large, big conga-like drum with a skin over it, and the huepnashli, which was a small log with two tongues on the side that was played with
just
little
the
mallets. And Elizabeth has all this material. This, of course, led to rhythms of the earth. The people of Mexico dance with their feet and with their bodies at a 45-degree angle, approximately. And we know this from the sculptures and the paintings and the things that we found so far, because a lot of this was destroyed purposely by the church and the Spanish people to start the Spanish culture invasion there. Then what happened here is that you had sounds, and I'll take off my shoes real quickly just to give you an idea of what I'm talking about. You had basically rhythms of the feet on the ground, and they have found even footprints in choreography, and I'll show you that too. Now here are some rhythms, and then a choreographed piece that I have found in a very, very excellent book. Hold on. Those are basic Indian rhythms. Then we have this, which was found in a book.
Surely.
So we see then that we do have the different footwork that started. Now with the coming of the Spaniards, you see that there will be a difference because there is a blending not only with the Spanish culture, but the Indian culture, but we have a third culture added, which is the black culture. People seem to forget that Mexico had many, many African people brought in by the Spaniards to be used in the mines and to be used as cheap labor along with the Mexican Indians. And this changed the whole tone of Mexican music and dance. So what we get here now is, if Juana will give you a little bit of zapateado, here's a very, very classic footwork region from flamenco Spanish. Perfect, thank you. Now that is the granddaddy of the Spanish footwork. This is the grandchild of that material right now.
Oh, thank you.
And there you have your
Thank you so much. Actually, I hope that our sound checks out there didn't disturb your lecture too much. And just one thing, we couldn't go into the gold rush period, but we did just touch on just one number to include our folklorica heroine of early California, Lola Montez. So just listen to this ballet extracted from an opera that I'm working on about the ballad of Lola Montez, and to mention our lovely dancer, Rosa Maria Torres Watson, she will represent the contemporary side of this. So when you hear Song for Gathering Acorns, although the mode is really from the northern Indian area, she's going to show a transition here and as to how this could be done for contemporary dance and many artists. Well, once again, my thanks for meeting with all of you, and please don't hesitate following our performance to have those questions. The Salterio, I did want to show this. Dr. Neuberg put one in the exhibit, and I think it's very important. The two marvelous artists that I was previously working with were from Mexico, but they have since passed on, and I'm having very difficulty in finding someone who can put this instrument that Dianza brought and was used in the missions, and it's marvelous, but we're playing it today on the Spanish classical guitar. So with that, thank you very much.